Max Frazier, another ET contactee, met the Greys many times. We don't use his real name to protect his privacy. Max grew up in a hunting family in the woods along the Mississippi River in Iowa and learned to be an expert marksman at an early age. As a teenager, he enlisted in the U.S. Army, where his talents with a rifle were quickly recognized, winning him many shooting medals and promotions. He volunteered for multiple tours in Vietnam and was sometimes deployed alone behind enemy lines, where dangerous conditions often strained his survival skills to the limit. One day, after being honorably discharged from the Army, Max was trying to relax on the beach in France, but he was struggling with his transition to civilian life. He missed the regiment of military life but was gradually adapting. That's when Max first met the ETs. He knew nothing about UFOs and, frankly, didn't have the slightest bit of interest. After being in the Army, he felt that something was real only if you could see it through a rifle scope. Max had almost dozed off on the beach when something shaded the sun from his face. He opened his eyes to see standing around him half a dozen 4-foot-tall, spindly, gnome-like humanoids with grayish skin. After years of jungle combat, he instantly went into full alert combat mode. Immediately, the ETs telepathically assured him, "We are not here to hurt you." Max was thoroughly surprised to be hearing voices in his head. He thought maybe he had been out in the sun too long and was hallucinating. Reading his mind, the Greys told him, "We are just as real as the people on this beach." Max glanced around him. Several people were lounging about 10 feet away on either side of him but were not paying the slightest attention to these strange little gray creatures. He wondered, if these little people are real, why don't other people see them? He wearily asked, "What do you want?" One of the Greys responded mentally, "We want you to help us get out the story about civilizations on other planets." Max thought about that for a moment. He really didn't care whether or not ET civilizations existed, and so, he countered, "Why would I do that?" One Grey responded, "It will be good for you and others to know. Your planet is soon to experience terrible catastrophes, and we are here to warn anyone who will listen. Only a few will." "Why are you asking me?" Max responded. "You are listening to us, but most humans will not," they answered. Having just experienced violent combat in Vietnam, Max sometimes worried whether the human race would survive the seemingly never-ending wars. So, what they asked made sense to him. Thinking about the Greys' offer, Max didn't agree but didn't say no either. Changing the subject, one Grey showed him a mental image, like a photograph, of a pretty woman with a friendly smile and told him, "This is the woman you will meet and marry." Max was a little miffed and replied sternly, "Well, that's none of your business, is it?" They responded, "You will like her. Remember this meeting when you see her for the first time. We will see you again." With that, the Grey simply vanished. As startled to see them leave as to arrive, Max was confused. Eventually, he dismissed the meeting as a daydream and put it out of his mind. Then, about a year later, the Grey's prediction came true. He met, recognized, and eventually married the woman in the mental image they showed him. Not long afterward, the Greys showed up again to begin a decade-long association with Max, involving multiple face-to-face contacts and many trips on ET ships, some of which we have described in this book. Years later, the Greys' prankish mentality became clear to Max one night, not long after midnight. Four Greys landed their small ship in a vacant lot and crossed the street to Max's house in a small town in Iowa. Max told Sarah that he had watched them do this several times and always wondered how they got across the highway without being seen. Max finally concluded that, just as on the beach in France, he was the only one that could see them. This time, Max didn't see them because he was asleep. Since serving in the jungles of Vietnam, Max had always been a light sleeper. He had trained himself to be in constant survival mode so that he could jump from deep sleep into action at a moment's notice. It was life or death in the jungle. Through quick response, he had lived through many nighttime attacks by poisonous spiders, venomous snakes, and Viet Cong assassins. After crossing the street, the four Greys entered Max's bedroom and one of them, true to their nature as tricksters, tickled Max's wrist to wake him up. Startled, Max switched into survival mode. Instantly, he grabbed the gray's arm and tossed it through the air across the room, where it crashed headfirst into the wall. The other grays quickly stepped back out of Max's reach and tried to calm him down, saying, "Relax. It's just us." The one who tickled his arm got up off the floor, rubbing its head, and said telepathically, "We didn't realize you were so strong." Max looked up at them and said, sternly, "Don't ever do that again." And they didn't. Other writers have mentioned the Gray's trickster mentality. Whitley Strieber describes how the Grays woke him up every night for years by blowing on the back of his hand or face, and sometimes even kissing him. In another trickster incident, Strieber woke up suddenly when the Grays pinched his right nipple and shook it. Not the most pleasant way to wake up, but the trickster Gray seemed to enjoy surprising humans.